Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to
page 1018 in the Pew Bibles, Luke 16, verses 19 through 31. Before I get to the sermon, I wanted to share this with you. The topic of this is decision. No power on earth or under earth can make a man do wrong without his consent. It is not a question of who is right, but what is right. It is never too early to decide for Christ, but the time will come when it will be too late. He who provides for this life, but takes no care for eternity, is wise for a moment, but a fool forever. Those quotes come from Croft M. Pence's The Complete Book of Zingers, and especially because of the one that refers to deciding for Christ. It's never too early, but the time will come when it's too late, because today we're going to be talking about the question, is it ever too late to receive salvation? It's continuing in the series we started last week, where we went through the attributes of salvation to try to understand exactly what salvation is, and that is available for anybody who wants to listen to it. I can burn a CD of that. Today we want to talk about what could easily be a very short message. In this message, I could just repeat the question, is it ever too late to receive salvation, and then plainly answer it with one word, yes. There does come a time that it's too late. And having said that, having told you that once you have died, it's too late to change your mind, then we could go on and have the altar call and go home. However, those of you who know me know that I am not known to be a man of few words or short sermons. And I would hate to ruin my reputation by having one today. It's not long, but it's longer than just that one sentence. In addition to which, if I left you with a brief explanation like that, I would be doing you a very great disservice. So please, turn with me to Luke 16. Beginning with verse 19, hear now the word of God. There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and you are tormented. And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then he said, I beg of you, therefore, Father, that you would send him to my father's house. For I have 5 brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham said to him, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, No, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said to them, If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rise from the dead. May God add his blessing to the reading and the hearing of his holy word. As we begin today's message, I would like you to note this is not the same Lazarus that is Mary and Martha's brother, friend to Jesus, that Jesus raised later from the dead. This is a parable Lazarus used to make a point. And though it is possible that this actual situation was something that was an occurrence in the past that Jesus was aware of, I believe that he was using this as he normally does in parables just to make a point to people. Although the text doesn't specifically tell us so, I believe that we can safely accept the premise that Lazarus had met the requirements necessary to avoid eternal damnation. I say this because he ends up in Abraham's arms. This Lazarus story, or the Lazarus of this story, has had a rather rough life, and upon his death was taken by angels to Abraham. Based on what Scripture tells us about our eternal lives after we leave this earthly plane of existence, we can also accept the premise that Lazarus is no longer in pain and that his sores have healed. The unnamed rich man, however, has a different story. He lived a life of luxury, but apparently had not met the requirements necessary to avoid damnation after his death. You may note that I am not saying anything about either of these two men's relationship to Jesus Christ, or about what they believe was accomplished at Calvary's cross. And the primary reason for that is that at this point in Scripture, Jesus is telling the story and he has not gone to the cross yet. Since he has not gone to the cross, these men can have no relationship to that other than what Moses and the prophets have told them and what they have listened to. Their faith is based in the Old Testament, and up until Jesus' death, faith is based on things to come. And that is what the beggar had his faith based on, but apparently not Lazarus. Please note, too, that we are not focusing on the pre-Christ requirements for entering into heaven. Though I briefly touched on them, that's not today's topic. Although, if you'd like, in the future, we can delve into that topic more deeply and spend a Sunday talking about the Old Testament and what was required to get into heaven as far as your faith of the future. Let's get back to the rich man, though. His story reveals a number of things to us. One of the things that he reveals to us is that Hades, the place of torment, is in flames, and that there is no water there to quench what is a terrible thirst. Also, that a part of the torment is that the rich man can see Abraham and Lazarus, and assumably other people who are in the heavenly realm, that he can see them, but has separated them for eternity by a great gulf. Now, at first reading, might be tempted to say, well, if there's a great gulf, why not dive into the gulf and get cooled off? Those who've been down to the Gulf of Mexico know that it's a wonderful place to go. Well, the literal translation of this great gulf is a vast chasm. So it's just a wide open space. It's not water. It's a large chasm that separates them for eternity, so they cannot approach each other. Looking at how this story applies our topic of salvation, we see Abraham telling the rich man that there is nothing he can do for him. In effect, what he is saying is, you're dead. There's no hope. It's too late. You lost your chance. And although Abraham makes mention of the apparent economic living conditions that both men lived their lives in, he does not say, and I do not think that Jesus means to imply, as a matter of fact, I'm certain that Jesus does not mean to imply by telling this parable, that wealth or lack thereof, or the living conditions that you spend your life in, physically, have anything to do with salvation. It's the living conditions morally and the acceptance of Christ. We'll get to that in a minute. Jesus is making clear two very important points with this story. First, there's already enough information available to all, that is, the stories that were recorded by Moses and the prophets, the prophecies that were told. At this point in time, there's already enough stories available to everyone to make the right decision. And that if a person chose to make the wrong decision, chose to ignore that information, then even someone raised from the dead would not be able to change their mind. Perhaps that was a thinly veiled reference to his own future as to what was going to be coming of him. Second, once you have ended your mortal life, we are told here that there is an eternal life waiting, and that is either heaven or hell. And the choice that you make must be made before the grave. All the remorse over things done or undone, all the wishing things had been different, all the what-ifs will not make a bit of difference once the last breath has been expelled from your body. And none of us has the slightest knowledge of when our death will occur. So, it makes sense to go with the idea that your decision must be made right now. Now, please understand, I'm not trying to scare anyone into making the decision to accept Christ. I'm only stating plain, simple facts, telling you what is obvious. I also want to point out that today's message is not intended in any way to focus on the free will versus predestination debate. It's not intended to focus on salvation through grace versus salvation through works. Those things are basically irrelevant for today's discussion. And actually, I would prefer that you set them aside and don't even consider them as we are talking about making a decision for Christ. Just don't even think about those things. It's all too easy to get mired down in theological technicalities when we're thinking about salvation and not make a choice because we're so confused. We put off thinking about where we are in our relationships with our Father. And when this happens, guess who wins? It's not you. It's not God. That's right. The old father of deception is relishing every single minute that anyone spends in a state of indecision about their commitment to Jesus Christ. Just because they don't understand the technicalities, or because they are tired of hearing, quote, mature, unquote, Christians arguing back and forth about what is right and what is wrong and the differences of theology. We as Christians need to put aside our differences of opinion and focus on the topic at hand. If you are not saved before you die, you will never be saved. Period. That's the thing I want you to focus on. No living person can pray a dead person into salvation. In fact, we're told not to pray for the dead. No dead person can go before God. I mean, you see this in the movies, but it doesn't happen. No dead person can go before God and say, all right, I understand, I get it now, give me a second chance, and get a second chance. Once you're dead, that's it. You don't convince God that he made a mistake, or there's so many movies out there now about people that wind up at the gates to heaven, and St. Peter tells them that they don't belong there, and they beg, and St. Peter gives them a chance to do three good deeds, sends them back on earth. You know, doesn't happen that way, folks. Once you're dead, You did. There's only one way to be absolutely certain that you're going to spend an eternity in God's kingdom. Accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. In John chapter 3, verse 18, Jesus says, "He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." Do not be half-hearted in your decision to accept Jesus as your Lord and Master either. For we read in Luke 13, 24 through 30, "Strive to enter through the narrow gate, for many, I say to you, will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen up and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock at the door, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open for us,' and he will answer and say to you, 'I do not know you, where you are from.' And then you will begin to say, 'We ate and drank in your presence, and we taught in your streets.' But he will say, 'I tell you, I do not know you, where you are from. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity.' There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of heaven and find yourself thrust out. They will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and sit down in the kingdom of God. And indeed, there are last who will be first, and there are first who will be last." Now, we're not going to get into the last, first, and first, last discussion today either. The point that's being made here is that Jesus is making it clear that salvation is not a laughing matter. It's not something to joke around about. It's not something to just put off and procrastinate. Take his word seriously. Ask yourself not, "Do I know Jesus?" but "Does Jesus know me?" Because that's what's important. Jesus says, "I know you not," or "I do not know you." All the begging in the world isn't going to help then either. We're going to talk more next week about exactly how you accept Jesus and how he becomes your personal Savior. But for now, please trust me. What I'm telling you is that it's something that must be done before it's too late. If you have not made the decision to accept Jesus Christ, or if you are uncertain, if you have fully given your heart to Jesus Christ, if you have fully claimed him as your personal Savior, if you have any doubts, then later on today, actually in just a short while, when we have an altar call, please come forward and speak to me and we'll pray. Or if you prefer, approach me after the service is completely over and we'll talk in private. Or make an appointment and we'll talk. Whatever is beneficial to you, just don't wait. Do not, and I cannot oversize the importance of this, do not wait under the assumption that there is plenty of time to accept Jesus later in your life. Only God knows what tomorrow holds. Not you and not I. For all we know, Jesus Christ could be preparing to return at this very moment. And if in fact that were so, then God's word tells us what to expect. In Matthew 13, 40 through 43, we read, "Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of this age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, all those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Now, Jesus gives this warning quite frequently in Scripture. "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Not just those people who were listening to him then, but for the ages to come, pastors who are preaching these messages, who are doing what I'm doing today, who are telling you, don't wait. Jesus is saying, I may come tomorrow. Be prepared. If you have ears, listen to what that man standing up front is telling you. So, I'm telling you what he told me to tell you. Now, there is one other instance in which it is too late to accept Jesus as your Savior. And only one other instance other than death, which I have been able to uncover in my studies of the Bible. You may have heard of the unforgivable sin, the unpardonable sin. That is, the sin that once committed prevents a person who committed it from ever receiving forgiveness or salvation. And there is so much confusion over what that unforgiven sin is. We find Jesus making reference to it in Mark 3, 28 through 30. Assuredly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the sons of men, and whatever blasphemies they may utter. But he who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is subject to eternal condemnation because they said he has an unclean spirit. Now, I must admit, that verse petrified me for a long time. I had no idea if I had committed the unforgivable sin or not. During the years that I was away from God, even denying his very existence, during the years that I was ridiculing those who believed in him, during my times of drunkenness when I was conning churches out of money, during the days when I was uncaringly breaking any and every commandment that I could think of to break without so much as a second thought, during those parts of my life, had I intentionally or unintentionally, and not remembering because of the fog of those days, had I committed that one sin from which there was no turning back? I had denied God. I had turned my back on him. I had laughed at people. When I first began my journey back into reality, back into God's protective arms, I had no real understanding of God's word, and I didn't know if God would take me back. I didn't know if he would simply turn his back on me, as I had turned my back on him. I found out that our God is a loving God, forgiving and merciful, far beyond what any mortal mind can conceive. I also found out that I only thought that I had walked away from God, that in fact he had stayed with me throughout my entire journey, that I had not walked away from him. There is nowhere that you can go where God is not. God walked with me the whole time, protecting me from my worst enemy, myself. As I began to mature a little bit in my Christian walk, I began to wonder exactly what was the unforgivable sin, and how could someone know if they had committed it or not? For the answer, we have to look at the verses we just read, and we have to consider the events leading up to them. Jesus had been healing the sick and injured. He had just healed a man with a withered arm in a synagogue on the Sabbath. And I'll tell you, that had driven the Pharisees and the scribes nuts. They were angered to the point of wanting him dead for doing that good deed on the Sabbath. He'd also been casting out demons out of people who were possessed by demons. In addition, he gave the power to do these same things to his 12 closest disciples, and he sent them out to teach and to heal and to cast out demons. As more and more people came to Jesus for healing, as more and more people came to Jesus to have the demons cast out, the Jewish leaders began to get worried. They began to wonder. They were afraid. This man was gaining power. Was he going to become so powerful that they would lose control of the people? In the midst of a particularly large group of people, just after the return of the 12 disciples, the Pharisees and scribes made a charge against Jesus that they thought was sure to destroy him in the people's eyes. They accused him of casting out demons by using the power of Beelzebub, Satan. In response, Jesus told them that that was a ridiculous charge, because the head of demons would not cast out demons. A house divided would not stand. In context then, knowing that was the situation, we reread these verses in Mark 8, 28 through 30. Assuredly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the sons of men, and whatever blasphemies they may utter, but he who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is subject to eternal condemnation because they said he has an unclean spirit. What Jesus was saying was that he had been healing and casting out demons by the power of the Holy Spirit. You recall when he was baptized, the Holy Spirit descended on him like a dove? Well, he was using the power of the Holy Spirit to cast out the demons. And these Jewish leaders, in effect, by what they said, were accusing the Holy Spirit of being Satan. And that is the greatest blasphemy of all. These men could never be forgiven for that blasphemy. They were condemned for eternity for their sin. There was no redemption, no cleansing by the blood to come, no forgiveness, only the eternal torment which we have talked about earlier. How can I tell if I have ever blasphemed the Holy Spirit? You might ask yourself. I did. I believe that I have the answer for you. So I am going to put forth my belief, and it is this. If a person has blasphemed the Holy Spirit and thereby received eternal condemnation, then that person would no longer be led by God to care enough about their salvation to ask. In short, if you ask about your soul, then you care about your soul. And if you care about your soul, then your soul is not lost. That just kind of makes it kind of brief and easy to grasp. Now, mind you, first off, asking about your soul does not guarantee salvation. It only guarantees that you don't have eternal condemnation. And second, it does not mean that you are... It does not mean that this is God's word. What I'm saying is this is my belief. This is how I look at it. If you care enough to ask, then you haven't lost any chance. It's kind of like the psychiatrists say, if you're sane enough to worry about being crazy, then you must not be. Well, it's kind of the same thing. If you care enough about your soul, if you worry enough about spending an eternity in the lake of fire, if you worry about that and don't want it, then you are not already condemned. Because if you were already condemned, you wouldn't care. You would be free to do whatever you wanted to do, whatever sick and demented thing was on your mind. We read that in Romans, but I won't get to that. We're running short on time. So, to the primary question, is it ever too late to receive salvation? Yes. If you are dead, or if you blaspheme the Holy Spirit. Assuming that if you are here today, you do not meet either of those two conditions, none of you are dead, and since you are here, I'm assuming you have not blasphemed the Holy Spirit. Assuming that, I invite you now to come forward. As we open the altar, we begin to pray. And as we open the altar, I want you to know that you can come forward to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You can come forward to profess your faith, to reaffirm your faith, or just to pray for any reason, or you can sit in your seats and pray. As the music plays, you are all invited to come forward if you would like.